So, it's my great pleasure to welcome Dr. Don John. Many of you will already know Don, but for those who don't, Don arrived in Southampton in 1977 to work as a youth and education officer for the Southampton Council for Racial Equality. He spent the last 43 years working tirelessly for Black, Asian and minority ethnic communities in the city. Appointed director of the SCRE, then lead race and diversity officer for Southampton City Council, Don now works as a consultant on racial issues for local authorities, the police and the armed forces. In 2005, alongside Jay Shah, Don founded Black History Month in Southampton. Since then, he's organised and participated in countless events, exhibitions and talks. Don is the author of The Black History of Southampton, available at October Books, and his TED talk, Black History Matters, has been viewed 80,000 times on YouTube. As if this wasn't enough, Don was also manager of the legendary British reggae band Ebony Rockers, set up the film production company, the Black and Asian Video Panel, and DJs on Voice FM's Night Moves and Soul Train radio shows. So without further ado, Dr. Don John.
Thank you very much, David. How can I live up to all of that stuff, eh? Anyway, good evening, everybody, and I'm glad you're here. It's certainly better to be in front of your monitor than out there in the horrible, cold, windy and rainy weather. Okay, now, 2020, what a year. A year that saw the murder of George Floyd, the rise of the Black Lives Matter movement, and in the UK, the highest number of stop and searches in 7 years, with black and brown people stopped four times more than white people, and Sainsbury's flying Black Lives Matter banners and a plethora of black images on TV over the last few weeks. In the words of Marvin Gaye, what's going on? Now, before I came to Southampton in March 1977, I must confess that I had little idea there were many black people in the city. And strangely enough, there are many who still believe that to this day. And the presumption is that the very few live in and around the inner city Derby Road area and contribute very little to the personality of the city. For a number of reasons, the city of Southampton has had a real difficulty in accepting the presence of black people as part of the legitimate history of Southampton. And unfortunately, the black presence is still somewhat marginalized today. I saw a recent video on social media titled Visit Southampton 2020, promoting the city's compliance with the government's COVID guidelines and declaring what a fun place it was. And there were hardly any black or Asian people featured in this piece. I think this tells a little bit about how officially the black presence is really valued. Now, once upon a time, black history was all about this dark continent that was peopled by these strange dark people who'd not really achieved a great deal and were saved by the goodwill of European domination. Unfortunately, there are many who still believe this to be true. And this view contributes, in my view, to the racism that many experience today. The bit that is left out is that much of what the Western world has today is a consequence of the sometimes involuntary contributions of black people that are purposefully not acknowledged or not known. Now, a black history of Southampton at first seems like a contradiction in terms, and when we think of black history, the names that immediately come to mind are, of course, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, Angela Davis, and others. Now, having been born and brought up in London, it was not uncommon to see the presence of black people and reminders that there was some historical legacy, even though one had to dig deep to discover the more positive aspects of that history and legacy. My work as the director of the Race Equality Council in Southampton highlighted how ignorance of why Black people were here in the first place and the part they play and had played in the city substantially contributed to the racism that I had to deal with in my professional capacity. Now, there was a general assumption that Black history was primarily about slavery, and that was the only legacy that Black people had. And this contributed to the notions, in my view, of white superiority and Black inferiority. And some of the consequences of that was racial discrimination and sometimes racial attacks. Moreover, we must not underestimate the impact of the slave trade on white people and Black people physically and psychologically, and how this insidiously lay the foundation for what was to come. Essentially, the birth of racism in the Western world. Now, Southampton, although a lesser port, saw its share of profits in part directly from the slave trade, although primarily through trade and commerce. The British Empire and British wealth was founded on the labour of slavery. Now, this truth sits uncomfortably with those who assume that their wealth was a consequence of their wisdom and skills and the will of God. And the recent Colston issues in Bristol bear testimony to this. And let us not forget the part played by the church that provided a moral justification for these deeds. Furthermore, there was a sinister side to Southampton's prosperity. Much of its newfound wealth was an outcome of this pernicious transatlantic trade in human cargo that was slavery. Although not many slaves were actually shipped through Southampton, many wealthy and influential people who lived in this city owned plantations. And the town played its part in both the furthering of this trade and, ironically, later in its eventual abolition. It all began with the slave trade, and the reality is that many European countries like Portugal, Britain, France, Spain, and the Netherlands all benefited substantially from what we call this bit of business. Cheap cotton and cheaply produced goods like sugar and chocolate contributed to the industrialization of European economies. In fact, so much sugar was imported to Southampton, which then was known as a spa town, that it had its own sugar house and even had a street named after it, Sugar House Lane, on the east side of Lower High Street, for those who know the city, where it was refined and processed before sold on. This business was so lucrative that the term as rich as a West Indian, the absentee sugar barons, was commonplace. Now that is what 400 years of free labor does for you: business, money, and wealth. The story of Black people in Southampton is a direct consequence of the city's maritime experiences. From the presence of a Black settlement in Tudor times to a Southampton financially invested in the transatlantic slave trade. From the contributions of Black people in the two world wars that include 700 South Africans who died at sea off the Isle of Wight on the SS Mendi as part of the war effort, to fighter pilots and sailors who fought in defense of this country, and of course, as a gateway to the Caribbean. The Black presence in the city is now 3 to 4 generations old, and although not all came through the ports, the porters played a crucial part in their presence here. The thing is, they're none so blind as those who will not look at their own history. And the special thing about Black history is that it makes us re-examine what we once held to be truths, and it compels us to reflect on the histories that are still to be told. Britain's maritime history, the Empire, and Southampton form a triangle that has benefited the city socially, economically, and spiritually. History is not the past, it's reflected in the present. and we carry our history with us, and we need to know that to know who we are. It is hoped and anticipated that the Black history of Southampton will cease to become Black history and will in the future be considered to be part of the legitimate history of the city of Southampton. We judge by our history, and this is a history that cannot be ignored and a truth that must not be forgotten. So how have recent events contributed to our appreciation of that history? Do they confirm existing prejudices, or do they help us to appreciate there's still much to be done? Now, in the wake of the killing of George Floyd and the rise of the Black Lives Matter movement, many individuals and institutions have grappled with how they can respond to this phenomena in a positive way. However, one thing that many fail to appreciate is that Black Lives Matter is not really a movement, but a level of consciousness, and it can only impact as much as you accept its significance and allow that significance to shape your worldview and your actions. Now, the world was justly horrified by the execution of George Floyd by the police in the USA. This reminded us all of the way that Black men have been treated and criminalized in the Western world. Unfortunately, the image of a Black man pinned to the ground by a police officer is symbolic of that relationship. Moreover, the picture of other police officers standing guard while this is happening tells us something about those who see racism and choose to look the other way, and who could be described as cheerful collaborators. Now, firstly, there has to be an ideological empathy with the notion that, broadly speaking, Black people have been subjected to racism in a very different way than many other ethnic groups, and certainly more than those defined broadly as white. However, there are some who have difficulty accepting this, even in our own communities. Now, some may think that this issue is not as bad in the UK as in the USA, and they refuse to admit that we in this country are only a few steps away from the American experience. Many of us have always argued that Southampton's disgraceful record on Stop and Search, which is reflected in other parts of the UK, is a stepping stone to other violations and the thin end of the wedge in denying personal freedoms. And some of us are already aware of the disproportionately high numbers of Black people in the criminal justice system. Now, although there's clear evidence that other BME individuals experience racism, there needs to be a clear appreciation that the racism that Black people experience is very different. And that is not denying the racism experienced by other ethnic minorities. We also need to more closely examine who falls into that Black category, which may vary from one community to the next. This is not easy, as the notion of Blackness is very much from the perception of the aggressor and may not necessarily be shared by those targeted. As you can see, we've not even got to working out what we're going to do, but the first step is crucial. And I'm sure some of you may ask, well, what about those of mixed heritage? As I said, it's not easy. Now, many years ago, in the good old days, I was constantly on the road delivering race awareness courses and delivering information to organizations to support them in developing practices and policies to ensure their organizations were not discriminating on the grounds of race. Some got it, some ticked the box, and some said, political correctness gone mad. However, the reality that we failed to take on board was world events and the political complexion of the governments and their willingness to provide a moral authority that could guide and support these initiatives. Over the last 20 years, this moral authority has been eroded by circumstances beyond our control that include 9/11, 7/7, foreign wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, the refugee and asylum seekers crisis, and of course, good old Brexit. And all of these events have made us, as a nation, in my view, less sympathetic in pursuing workable policies that seriously impacted on racism. Now, some even believe that we were in a post-Obama phase and the Black experience could only improve. And then the other shoe dropped. It seems to me that an appreciation of these circumstances is a fundamental element in understanding how we got here in the first place. So what do we do now? Well, firstly, we need to appreciate that whatever we do, we must rely on our own personal ingenuity and our commitment to wanting to make this thing work. We need to consider placing the definitions of what constitutes racism in the hands of those who are the receiving end, and that would be a start. Back in the day, we used to do this thing called ethnic monitoring, but it fell into disrepute because very little was done with the fruits of that monitoring. Essentially, institutions need to know their demographic and record the presence of Black people and make that evidence available and understandable. I must say the police have actually been pretty good in doing that, and therefore they draw a lot of criticism as a consequence. There are many organisations in the Southampton region who have been supportive of policies and practices that recognise and respond to racism. However, there has been a failure to recognise the political and social dynamics that have made it more difficult to respond to the way that ordinary levels of racism have insinuated their way into the system, and how we have allowed ourselves to disregard the manner that institutional racism manifests itself. One of the big problems is the repeated denials that race is an issue, and that sometimes the suggestion is that it's all about Black people's oversensitive imagination and what they used to call the chip on their shoulder. And other words have now been found for that condition. Now, Black Lives Matter was a one-shot wake-up call and gave us all an opportunity to get to the next level. The call for a race advice centre in Southampton was supported by the people, but rejected by the established organisations, and was a sad indicator of how Black Lives Matter is not really having the impact that many are suggesting it has. And conversely, many are now distancing themselves from the basic sentiments and finding convenient ways to back away, and sometimes even changing the name of the movement. I think it was the Football Association have now called it No Room for Racism. Sounds more palatable than Black Lives Matter, I guess. There will be further opportunities, and the hope is that we will rise to the challenge. Sadly, a catchy slogan alone will not defeat racism, but I still live in hope. Now, Black history has done much to bring the condition of Black people, or should I say Black History Month, has done much to bring the condition of Black people to the attention of those whose perception of Black people comes from fairy tales contrived to rationalize the horrors of the colonial experience. And the Black Lives Matter movement has reminded us there is much still to be done. Black History Month must retain its connection as a learning tool to identify and challenge racism, and not reduced into a form of entertainment for those who want to tick the diversity box. And in the words of Angela Davis, it's not to be the difference that makes no difference and the change that brings no change. Thank you. Over to you, David. More than happy to answer any questions you may have, and I hope this gives fruits for further discussion.
Well, thanks, Don, for that incredibly fascinating and thought-provoking paper. I think Don suggested that before I ask questions, we move to audience questions. So if you have any questions, please input them using the Q&A tab. Now, I was really interested in something you said about how you made the point that the racism faced by Black communities is kind of different from the racism faced by other ethnic groups. I wonder if you could expand on that and talk about the ways in which this racism is different.
Well, it sounds like too obvious an example, but certainly the darker you are, the more you're seen to be different, and therefore the more racism will actually, you'll attract racism far more. And clearly this was used in the colonies when those who were lighter skinned were given more privileges than those who were darker skinned. And that kind of like the way in which Black people were discriminated against, people have taken that experience and brought it into the West. And we can see certainly that when it comes to integration, some people argue that white people are more comfortable with Black people as long as they're not too Black. And I guess that operates not just in a physical way, but also, you know, sort of psychologically, and also in terms of how they feel people may fit in. And I guess in the Black communities, we have people of many different complexions. And certainly there's something called shadism or colorism, which basically is a way in which, even in our own communities, people are treated differently according to the complexion of their skins. And this is a leftover from the colonial experience. So certainly that manifests itself, particularly when it comes to issues of criminality and the criminal justice system, in which certainly with Stop and Search, and we've seen a report that only came out a couple of days ago, in which it said that people of African descent and darker ones were subjected far more to Stop and Search, because I guess authorities make the association that the darker you are, the more susceptible you are to sort of criminality. And Stop and Search, to a certain extent, operates within those kind of determinations.
It's fascinating that you talk about those historical connections. Certainly something I talk about with my students is the kind of three-tier system that operated in Jamaica during the slavery period, when the middle tier would be the free Black community, which was often lighter skinned.
That's right. Even in the Americas on the plantations, there were differing degrees of, there were quadroons and octoroons, which are the eighth white, and all the rest of it, you know, in which there were gradations that were determined by the colonial masters, which basically gave you value according to the levels of complexion that you had.
Okay, we've got a few questions here. Pamela asks, based on your experience, do you feel organisations are moving in the right direction? Any advice or tips? Pamela's from Solent NHS.
Yeah, well, there's a lot more to be done. I think there's there's an upside and a downside with Black Lives Matter, the whole philosophy, is because it gave people the opportunity to actually register their political position when it comes to race. But for some people or some organisations, it was the end of the process. And what we really need now to do is, in the words of Elvis Presley, of all people, a little less conversation, a little more action, because there is a lot of conversation about racism. But when you translate that into activities and action, it's not quite as tangible as it could or should be. And it seems to me we need to really look at outcomes. We need to look at, let's look at Stop and Search. If the outcomes were that fewer people were stopped and searched based on their race, I would argue that I'd like Black people to be stopped as often as white people, which sounds a bit kind of weird in a sense, because that would mean that at least we were treated equitably in terms of criminality. But the police are going to make, you know, sort of two decisions. Either Black people are more criminal and therefore they should be stopped more, or alternatively, they should be stopped proportionately to everybody else. So outcomes are crucial. And what I'd like to see organisations do is say, well, we recognise racism is an issue. Our outcomes are going to be this. And that relates to activities, and it relates to employment, and it relates to also being able to recognise, you know, racist discrimination, racial harassment, and all that goes and contributes to the condition that Black people find. Because clearly racist actions and racism and racial harassment are ingredients that determine the way in which racism actually operates in any of these institutions. And if there is not an open and accessible means of being able to challenge that racism, then we've got a problem. And I think that in many organizations, the capacity to be able to report to racism in a manner that isn't going to leave you wide open, it's very limited, because we talk about it a lot, but when you really, you know, dig deep in any of the major institutions, the capacity for Black people to register, you know, the racism they've experienced is very little, because firstly, they leave themselves wide open. And also, I mean, I think many Black people are being reluctant to actually even flag up the racism they've experienced, because very often it's used as a measure of the incapacity of Black people to deal with the situation. And therefore they'd rather step back a little bit. And also they'd be accused of what people call playing the race card. And that's been said a lot, particularly in the era when people talked about political correctness gone mad. Black people are somewhat reluctant to use their race, the experience of racism, to be able to challenge the system. And we've got to change the score on that one, I think.
Yeah, that's interesting that you talk about this, the accusation that certain groups are playing the race card. And I think that links into a question that Francesca's asked, which is, why do you think that the Black Lives Matter movement, it's been so hard for the establishment to accept that movement? Is it just their name, Black Lives Matter, or is it an excuse for them not wanting to, for the establishment not wanting to accept their privilege?
I think it's the reluctance for white organisations and many white people to accept the fact that there is white privilege. And most people don't like to think that what they've achieved is because they're white. They like to think what they've achieved is because they're good at what they do. But there needs to be a level of acceptance that, well, if somebody is in a good position in an organisation, it could very well be at the expense of other Black people who may have been better. And generally, human nature does suggest that people don't want to diminish their own capabilities. And seems to me that it's the reluctance to accept those privileges that is really at the centre of all of that. And I'm not sure whether we've got to that yet, so because it's kind of it's just difficult to really accept the fact that, well, yeah, I'm in this great position, you know, I'm, you know, Dr. David Cox, and it may very well be that there may have been a Black person who may have been able to do the job better than I, but I got it because I was white. No, I'm not just about you, David, but, like, do you know what I mean? In some circumstances, particularly when you look at the university sector, there are relatively few Black professors. And I'm sure some of them are probably as capable as some of the white professors who are professors. But of course, those professors aren't going to say, well, perhaps I did get it because I've got this white privilege. And it's hard for people to accept all of that.
No, I think you're exactly right. And in fact, the racial composition of the humanities departments in Southampton University is possibly something that should be thought about.
Something for scrutiny, perhaps.
Mm. We've got another question here from Professor Tony Kushner. What further work needs to be done to grow Black history in Southampton? What areas need more research, and how can this research be done?
Well, certainly, I mean, there's one thing that I'm involved in at the moment is developing the Southampton Black Archives. And it would be really great, and we're doing some work with the University of Southampton, Solent University, and Winchester University, to try and collaborate a little bit to bring all the examples of the Black presence together. And it needs those institutions to all commit themselves to the fact that we have a missing gap in the city. The missing gap is that there is a presence historically in the city other than a white presence. And we need to come together in order to be able to deal with that. Because I've always believed universities are always about, you know, the truth and bringing facts and the truth together. And I think as a city, many institutions can come together, because obviously universities has been an important part of expanding and developing these truths. And I'd like to see more done there, because in a sense, universities, I know it's difficult for universities now, but there's the wherewithal, there's capability, there's the intellect to be able to help us all to bring that together and to develop a base. And I know Tony has been involved in some of what we do. So it'd be really great if we could bring all those together. And we do have a Southampton Black Archives group, which has met once, I think, now. And it'd be great to have Tony on board with that, because he's done a lot of great work on the Jewish community. And certainly we would like to follow that through, because some of the work that there is and the information in the city is all over the place. And also there's a lot in personal collections that we'd like to bring together. Individuals in the Black community who don't even value the history that they have. And we'd like to bring all that together and try and do something a bit more substantial with that.
Yeah, I noticed that much of your book, The Black History of Southampton, is based on an oral history project which took place between 1983 and 1986, which seems the most amazing resource for local history and social history. And I know we had a conversation previously, you were saying that quite a lot of these interviews are dispersed, aren't they? They're not in one place, they need to be gathered together.
Absolutely.
Some kind of archive.
Yes, and I think it's perhaps the failure to recognise that this is valuable. This is valuable stuff, you know? And it's not just about, you know, the people who actually have lived it for generations. It's also about other people around the world who had an interaction with Southampton, which was a great port. And also people came on cruise ships and all the rest of it. I mean, there's a curious bit of information I have about Louis Armstrong, who was here in 1938 playing at some theatre in the centre of Southampton. And in my book, I also quote, we had an army of Black soldiers marching down Southampton City High Street. You never see so many Black people in Southampton, with guns as well, and they weren't stopped and searched either. So there's lots of curious bits of information which we really need to pull together. And that will at least make the young people in Southampton schools know, well, yeah, we had all this history here. Southampton is connected. It's not just about slavery, it's about so much else. And I think that, to a certain extent, will contribute to, generally speaking, the city's perception of the quality of the Black presence.
Great. We should move on. We've had a lot of questions now. We've got a question from an anonymous attendee. Says, I wonder if you could talk about how the definition of Black has changed over the past 30 to 40 years. Would you agree that it's become a lot more Afro-American centric? Is this a good change?
Very good question. Now, whether it's good, I'm not too sure. I mean, back in the 70s and the 80s, we were all Black because we were defined as those who were disadvantaged by the white establishment. So whether one was of Indian origin, Pakistani origin, Chinese origin, we were all Black. We consider ourselves Black. But that was a political convenience because, you know, we were all suffering the same kind of racism and discrimination. Clearly, as time went on, we all appreciated that different communities experienced different types of racism, which is a legitimate position to get to. And I think that it's worthwhile people actually also, you know, accepting their own sense of identity. And there's no problem with that. The difference between the UK and America is that America looked primarily at an African-American experience, mostly. Here we've got it quite mixed, really, all in all. You know, we've got people from the Indian subcontinent, people from and the Caribbean and Africa, and they're all uniquely different. You know, they've all got their different needs and their different wants, and even though people who discriminate may very well see them as one lump, and we know our differences. And I think it's not a problem if individual communities want to identify themselves. The terminology Black, I think now in the UK, is looking at those of African and Caribbean descent. And the question is it a good thing or is it a bad thing? Well, I don't know whether it's a good or bad thing. I mean, I think when we all were experiencing a similar kind of discrimination, it was good for us all to be lumped as black. But the reality is that we are different, even within our own communities, as black people of African and Caribbean descent, we are very different. Somebody from Zimbabwe is different to somebody from St. Vincent. And there's different needs that people will have. So I think it's quite legitimate to accept those differences. But at the same time, we should all be mutually supportive of the broad discrimination we all face. And I'm not sure whether we are as mutually supportive as perhaps we could or should be. And that's a discussion. And I think that's a discussion and an argument or whatever that still needs to be had. I think that's a great intellectual debate, that one.
Yeah, no, it's really interesting. And another, I'm just going down in order, so apologies to anyone if I haven't got your questions yet, to any attendees. But another question from the same person, which they've said at the end, I hope this isn't a stupid question. I think it's a superb question. It's actually, I've already asked Dom this question when we were preparing for this talk. It's, do people identify as black as a result of the racism they receive? I've never understood why someone who has a white mother and black father identifies as black and not white.
Yeah, it's a good one. It's not a stupid question at all, because I think, as I said in my presentation, the notion of blackness is very much the perception of the aggressor. So at the end of the day, if somebody's got a white father and a black mother or vice versa, then that won't be a plausible argument to have against the racist who is saying this, that and whatever. They will see all of us as one thing. And I think that people who raise the issue of their black and of mixed parentage, they know that the aggressor and the discriminator only sees the black side of things, and therefore they will identify with that. But it's a hard one for individuals to then be able to use that as a means by which they actually identify themselves. And at the end of the day, some people will accept it more than others, but this is why I raise the issue of those of mixed parentage. There's still a very difficult discussion to be had here. And there are many of mixed parentage and mixed heritage who identify themselves squarely with being part of the black community. But there are others who, you know, quite likely may say, well, no, because my mother is white, or my father is white, and whatever, and I don't necessarily identify with that. And again, that's another justifiable position to be in. But the reality of that experience may very well be how people have treated them. And if they treat them in the same way they would treat somebody who was clearly identified as black, then that would push them squarely into, well, if that's what you think I am, then that's what I'm going to be. So again, another discussion still to be had, and one we in the black communities still need to have that discussion, because the definition of mixed heritage is relatively new. And I've always argued that even when we go back to the days of Martin Luther King and Malcolm X was very light-skinned and of mixed heritage. In fact, a lot of African Americans are all of mixed heritage at the end of the day. But most of them would still, you know, identify themselves as black. So I think it's a uniquely UK thing that we need to grapple with. And I guess there'll be many discussions about that in the future.
Yeah, really interesting. Another question from, I want to say a lot, I want to talk to you a lot about these questions, but I want to definitely address everyone else's. From Veronica Gordon from Our Version Media, what message do you have for those organisations who shout loud with catchy slogans yet fail to actively address race issues within their organisations?
Well, the first thing to say to them is, well, thank you for supporting us on this and whatever. What are you going to do next? The thing is, it also may help to have an idea about what you want them to do next, and then to give people options. I always say that the only way you're going to test an organisation's commitment is having an idea of what you think their next step should be, and giving them the options of being able to pursue those next step or something not too dissimilar to that. So just accepting the fact that somebody is wearing a Black Lives Matter t-shirt, or you know, it's got the banner, whatever, and supports you. Because you got to appreciate that sometimes, and I think I said it in my presentation, supporting things like Black Lives Matter or even Black History Month is the beginning and the end of that commitment. And they don't go further beyond that. So we have to come up with the solutions ourselves and test those organizations and say, well, great, you know. I mean, like much in the same way, you know, we gave Southampton City Council the option, who support Black communities and all the rest of it and whatever. And we gave them the option to say, well, look, the big problem we have is Black people having the confidence to be able to make complaints about the race and the experience. And one way of being able to sort that out is by setting up a race advice service. So we gave them the option to move from, you know, supporting the principles of Black history and doing something about it. I'm afraid they failed. And I think many organizations will fail in the same way, because the posturing side of things is easy. Black Lives Matter has become a bit of a fashion, and a fashion that has been abused by the media anyway, who basically interpret as defunding the police and violence and all the rest of it. So we do have a problem in terms of translating the philosophies of Black Lives Matter into real actions that people will take. So even though it's fantastic, I love what people are doing to support it, we've got to ask the next question. And sometimes we as Black people fail to ask that question. And we kind of get into this collaborative process in which we're actually continuing or supporting and assisting the posturing and not moving on to the next step, which will be, well, whatever action we feel they shall take next. And so that is very, very important. But we need to come collective as a community to do that. We also need to know that we're not just going to let it lie. And sometimes, I think sometimes we're just happy to, you know, to be asked to sit at the table. And I'm not a great believer of sitting at the table alone. I believe we must go beyond sitting at the table. We've then got to say, well, this is what comes next.
Yeah, that's all really interesting points, and ones that resonate with me, because I myself kind of feel, you know, I've organized these events, but is that enough? And what more do I need to be doing to, you know, very important question. And a sort of on a similar note, we've got a question from Anwen, which is, hi Don, how do you see the role of schools and educators responding to Black Lives Matter?
Oh, wow, that's a really interesting one. There was a time in which, remember, we had a Black Director of Education at City Council a little while ago, and schools were very much influenced by the local authority, who at that time, 15 years ago, were pursuing a kind of proactive anti-racism policy. And therefore, the local authorities could influence the schools. Schools are now autonomous bodies. And very often they are sensitive about involving themselves in political matters. And also they're sensitive in terms of the views of, you know, the community, the parents who send their kids to school. And it's much harder now to actually deliver things to do with Black History and Black History Month. There is a movement now to develop a Black History curriculum, which many of us involved in Black History Month have been supportive of and wanted to pursue. But I think the very difficult thing is, and again, I flagged it up in my presentation, is we need a kind of like a broadly political empathy with that movement, which, you know, without wanting to go too political, we don't have at this time. We don't have a government that is comfortable with pursuing issues around race in and amongst the curriculum. And this is why schools themselves are reluctant to go down that particular road. So what the only thing we really have, and I think again I mentioned, we must rely on our personal ingenuity, is if you're a parent and you've got children at a particular school, you go into that school and you ask them, what are you doing about A, B, or C? Because people power is the only thing we really got now. Political power has been eroded because of the broader political complexion that we now have. And if you're a parent and you, and there are many parents who not necessarily have, you know, black kids or children of mixed race, but parents who believe in having an education system that is diverse. You go into that school and you talk to the head teacher, you talk to the board of governors, you say, I'm not comfortable. The fact that my child goes to this school and it doesn't even aware of the black presence in the city or the positive aspects, what are you as a school doing about that? Because, you know, schools now are very much dependent on, you know, people power and what the parents say. So again, there's an opportunity not to work necessarily within a political organisation, but to be there as a parent, as a citizen of the city, and, you know, not only go to the school, but also go to your local authority, to your local councillor, and to say, well, look, I'm not happy about this. And the more people that say this, the more the pressure will apply. And hopefully, as and when the political attitude towards Black history in the curriculum changes, things will develop further. Because it seems to me that it's knowing about the Black person and Black history will reduce racism in the city. It will reduce because people will have, you know, a more fuller understanding of matters relating to Black. Not just believing that if there's a Black kid in the school, they must have come from a underprivileged or perhaps a less civilized culture, which is what some people do believe. And so education, schools, crucial. But personal intervention is an important way of contributing, you know, to the whole story.
Thanks for that, Don. And we've got another question from Kendrick Oliver, who I warn you, Don, is my boss. So
I should be kind, don't worry.
Saying, really enjoyed your talk. He is interested in your statement, if he understands you properly, that at some point in the future we should reach a point where there is no need for Black History Month because Black history will be properly assimilated. And I went to a talk last week with Lou Taylor, who made the same point actually. And Kendrick just wonders, what criteria would you use to judge that point had been reached?
Oh, wow. Wow. I'm not sure. I mean, I think we're quite a long way away from that, to be frank. I mean, I think the criteria that we use is that our children come out of schools with a fuller knowledge. And this is why, you know, my book, Black History of Southampton, is crucial, because we don't want Black history to be something that's over there, that it's about, you know, the civil rights movement in the United States. We want to know about the way in which Black history has impacted on the place that we live. As I said earlier, every city, every significant city, major city in this country, profited from Black history. And, you know, we're doing some work in Southampton. Bristol has done a lot of work. But there are other places. Winchester, which is not too far away, there was a great impact of Black history in Winchester. If every part of the country did its own examination and injected those thoughts and those inquiries into the system in a way that I guess, you know, schools can do, because, you know, I mentioned that the church had a lot to do with stuff, and the church certainly played a part in all of this, then I think that may be a way of us almost accepting ordinarily that, well, yeah, you know, there may not be that many Black people actually in this town or in this city, but it could very well be that, you know, there were people there who benefited from the trade itself. I mean, an example I always quote is there's a place called, there's an MP called Richard Drax. He used to be a BBC reporter once upon a time. And he's got this big estate, which is kind of just outside Poole. And his whole family for 300 years or whatever have been involved in plantations in the Caribbean. And they've got so many artifacts of colonial, the colonial experience there. But we did ask to go and check it out, but we were refused politely. So, I mean, what I'm basically saying is that every part of the country has got some relationship with the Black experience, because let's not forget that the whole of the British economy was benefited substantially. Even the stock exchange benefited substantially from the slave trade. And many people, many rich people in this country were paid vast amounts of compensation to give up their slaves. Of course, slaves didn't get anything, but they were paid a lot of money. And many people in Southampton were, and I guess many people in many other parts of the country. So, yeah, what is the criteria to determine that? Well, we just have to keep on keeping on with that. You know, we've got to keep on making sure that every place in the country looks at itself and says, well, did we as a city or as a village or whatever benefit in some way directly or indirectly from the slave trade?
Thanks, Don. We've had so many questions that we're not going to be able to get through them all. I really apologise if you've asked a question and we can't answer it. But this is an interesting one from Daniel Tuckman. He asks, with the current progression and understanding of Black history, how do you feel we can tackle those who are still oblivious, ignorant to this issue? And I think that it's an interesting issue, isn't it? Because kind of events like this are to some extent preaching to the converted, and how do you get beyond the kind of, how do you get to people who don't share these views?
Well, firstly, Daniel, how are you doing? Long time no see. Thank you very much for the question. Well, I think we used those who were converted or half converted, and you know, we used you people as missionaries. I'm sorry to use that terminology, but we want you to go out and make the change that's necessary, because some of you here are kind of half, you know, converted to what I'm saying. But you then need to go out and convert other people. They did that in Africa, so we can do it here. You know, you need to go out in the places where you have some influence, or the places that you know, you go out and you challenge things and you tell people that we need to do this and we need to spread this along the way, because there are still people out there who are not that interested, not necessarily converted, but you may have the influence and the capacity to change things in the places where you're at, where the issue is not even discussed. And the many people who are here, I'm sure, you know, competent people who may very well be able to make that little change elsewhere. There will, of course, be those people who will never be convinced, because sometimes the truth is just an uncomfortable addition to what it is they want to believe. But we have to forget about those people. But there are many who just kind of just sitting on the edge there and may just need a little push or a little bit of information or a little bit of education or whatever. And then we can get those people then to move it on elsewhere.
Well, thanks, Don. I think that's a great place to stop. And I'd really like to thank you on behalf of myself and the department and all of the attendees here for absolute superb talk and great conversation afterwards. So that was brilliant. So thank you, everyone, for coming.
Yes, thank you all. Thank you all for being here. And I've really enjoyed it. I could talk forever, of course, but we don't have time.
I had so many questions for you. So thanks very much, everybody.
Great. Thank you. Bye-bye.